I'm going to be speaking about the research that I've been doing that's specifically geared towards developing a parent sign language curriculum. This is specifically for American Sign Language. However, I'll be speaking in a broader sense today. If there's anything that's unclear throughout my presentation, please don't hesitate to ask a question I'm more than happy to answer during the presentation. There is quite a lot of text on my PowerPoint as well. Please don't worry about reading the entirety of it. It's just to help keep me on track with the points I'd like to touch upon. Okay, let's get started. Before I get into my research, I'd like to give a bit of background as to who I am and how I became involved in the field of working with parents in their acquisition of American Sign Language. This is one of the most crucial, important issues for me in my research. It's supporting hearing parents of deaf children in learning a sign language. I initially became involved when I was working with a deaf community organization by the name of the Ontario Cultural Society of the Deaf, OCSD. We were planning some training for deaf ASL instructors, which focused on how these instructors can work and support parents if they've recently discovered that their child is deaf or hard of hearing. So looking at how to support those parents, how to teach them ASL, how to give them guidelines and advice on developing literacy with their child. So the OCSD were the first organization to set up standardized training for this type of work. I believe they were working with AOSF in some capacity. However, LSQ community does need some more support. You know, ASL has had a number of more resources in place, but the LSQ community does need some further support with developing those. I worked with another deaf organization in Ontario, the Ontario Association of the Deaf, that commissioned me to write a discussion paper looking at service gaps for deaf children between the ages of 0 to 6. This work came into place because of a program that perhaps you're familiar with. It's called the Infant Hearing Program, also known as the IHP. This was implemented around the year 2000. During this time of the implementation of the IHP, we noticed that there were some issues when it came to children who were receiving AVT, auditory verbal therapy. So if they had used a hearing aid or a cochlear implant and were receiving AVT, the child was not permitted to learn sign language. OAD, the Ontario Association of the Deaf, asked me to investigate this to see if the policies that were in place were following the current research that was available about language competencies. My PhD research took place at the University of Toronto, where I focused on the Mother Goose program, the ASL Mother Goose program specifically. This again was implemented by the deaf community, and it was to engage in emergent early literacy, so for parents to read books with their children using sign language. Once I completed my PhD, I went on to pursue my postdoctoral studies, where I researched a small program that looked at how parents read books with their children in ASL, the ASL Shared Reading Program. I will touch upon that study briefly throughout my talk this morning. In 2013, I moved to the province of Alberta, where I lived for a one-year period, after which I relocated to Ottawa. And I have to let you know, I'm an Ontario girl, born and raised. This is my province. So I feel like I'm back at home here. But this is a little bit about my background, just so you can know who I am and where I've come from. I'd like to begin by discussing some of the theories, the theoretical framework about how we frame deafness and the phenomena of having a deaf child. I'd like you to reflect on the following question. Where does disability lie? Oftentimes, individuals have normalized the medical model of disability. The medical model looks at the individual themselves, the child in this case, in being the one that possesses a deficiency as lacking in some regard. So the medical model views the child as the one that needs to be fixed, the one that needs to be remedied in some sense. Parallel, on the opposite end of the spectrum, is the social model. This model of disability looks at society and the environment as a whole, the attitudes that are present within society, and those factors as being the cause of the barriers, and in turn, these barriers are what causes the disability. The social model is an interesting one. So for a hearing parent who's recently discovered that their infant or their child is deaf, will they view the child as possessing the disability, or will they view the disabilities as a product of societal barrier? If the parents were able to learn sign language, if they were welcomed into the deaf community, would there still be those specific barriers in place? Prior to my presentation, Karin was just discussing about where the responsibility lies, that it lies with parents and the professionals. And I agree, but I absolutely want to emphasize that the deaf community has a large responsibility to deaf children as well, which I will touch upon further in my presentation. The deaf community needs to support parents in their supporting of their deaf and hard of hearing children. The last model I'd like to touch upon here is the social relational model. This is a theory that I developed, and it aligns with the social model in looking at that disability lies within the societal barriers. However, the social relational model also takes into account the diversity between deaf and hard of hearing children, their diverse backgrounds, and the ultimate goal is to support them in being involved in their communities, whether they're learning ASL, LSQ, supporting them to be involved within those communities and also the hearing communities that they subscribe to as well. Of course, deaf and hard of hearing children, their parents come from a variety of different backgrounds, and we need to support them in being involved within those communities that they come from. The social relational model takes into account who the deaf child will grow into, so the adult that they will become. Good so far? Is this clear for everyone? Any questions? No? There's a specific type of research which is called longitudinal research. This research looks at a specific group, so a cohort of individuals, in this case deaf children, over a long period of time. So looking at the same group of deaf children over their childhood development, seeing which language they learn, at what age, and so forth. Anyhow, that type of research is few and far between. There's not many longitudinal studies available out there. However, there is still research that states that most deaf individuals at some point, at some age, will learn a sign language. Whether it's at the age of 5, 10, 15, I myself learned sign language at 21 years of age, or even later in life at 30 or 40 years. Deaf and hard of hearing children will learn a sign language and become involved within the deaf and hard of hearing community at some point within their lives. So if that's the outcome, if they're going to learn sign language and become involved within the deaf community, why don't we support and foster that language development at a younger age and help them become bilingual individuals from a young age? There is some other research that states that if deaf and hard of hearing children feel like they can communicate with their parents, it's crucial for their social, emotional, and psychological development. So again, the question comes back to the question as to whose responsibility is it to adapt communication styles? Is it the child's responsibility to learn how to communicate with their parent, or is it the parent's responsibility to communicate with their child? And again, there needs to be deaf community support to assist parents through this journey. As I was just speaking to when I was commissioned by the Ontario Association of the Deaf to write a paper looking at service gaps in the IHP for deaf children between 0 to 6, the issue came up about children who receive cochlear implants and are pursuing AVT. Under the IHP's policy, those children that are receiving auditory verbal therapy are not permitted to learn sign language. Now, I must say that this policy is not overtly stated. It is not an explicit policy within the IHP, and the reason being that it conflicts with other legislature. It's discriminatory to prevent a child from learning sign language. However, I've seen in a number of cases how this can impact parents, and this particular policy is an operational policy. So it's not overtly stated, but it is happening. So parents feel there are barriers being put on parents in their learning of a sign language. Here in Ottawa, we have CHEO, the Children's Hospital of Eastern Ontario, as well as Sick Kids in Toronto. There is also a hospital in Alberta by the name of Glenrose, a children's hospital, that also adheres to these policies. If a parent opts to receive auditory verbal therapy for their child, they are not permitted to learn sign language. I did publish this paper. If anyone's interested in reading further into it, I'd be more than happy to send out the article to you. There is absolutely no evidence that states that if a child is learning sign language, that it will negatively impact their development of spoken language skills. In fact, the evidence speaks to exactly the opposite. If a child is learning a visual language, it provides them with a foundational language, one that they can build upon to develop those spoken language skills. So receiving both AVT spoken language services as well as learning sign language work hand in hand. They benefit each other. So I did speak to one type of barrier, those barriers that are in place within the policies themselves at a governmental level. Another type of barrier is what I like to refer to as ideological barriers. So ideological messages that are put out there that people take to heart. In the realm of deaf education, there are a number of experts around the world that are often revered for their opinion and expertise. Most of these experts do not support parents in learning a sign language. Why is this? What's some of the rationale that they wouldn't support parents in learning sign language? I investigated this, and perhaps some of you have already encountered this particular reason, but one of the reasons that's stated is if a parent chooses to learn sign language, there will automatically be a language delay for their child. And the reason being that the parent will never become skilled or proficient enough in that sign language. Perhaps some of you have heard that rationale before. And I'd just like to say that there is absolutely zero evidence to prove that that statement is true. The logic behind that statement is a bit shaky. Parents to date have not had any support in their learning of a sign language, and their children still have a language delay. So if we're able to support parents in learning a sign language, will there still be that linguistic delay there? I don't think so. The second rationale that experts say that parents should not learn sign language is due to practical reasons. They say that it's simply too difficult for parents to learn a sign language. They couldn't possibly provide the level of exposure to that sign language that the child needs. But you need to remember, with the work that I did with OCSD, the Ontario Cultural Society of the Deaf, we trained 8 ASL instructors across the province of Ontario to provide that service to parents. So the service is available out there, and I believe that parents can become skilled in the sign, in that sign language. So rather than it being too difficult for parents to learn it, I believe that there are systemic barriers in place that are actually preventing the parent from being able to learn that language. There's an important point that I'd like to state about the parent sign language curriculum and why it's so crucial to have. I'm not sure if anyone in here is familiar with the signing naturally curriculum. Perhaps you've seen it if you've taken a sign language class. A number of courses out there implement this specific curriculum. But the signing naturally curriculum doesn't really align with the skills that parents need to learn in sign language. Signing naturally curriculum is wonderful for training people to become interpreters, for training individuals to become teachers of the deaf. So hearing in adult learners, training to become interpreters or teachers of the deaf, but this curriculum doesn't really align with the skills that parents need to learn. So we're going to be looking at two groups of second language sign language learners, adults, and the first group being those who want to become interpreters. There's a different motivation for their learning of that language. They need to learn the language for their future profession, for work purposes. Parents, on the other hand, have a different need for needing to learn sign language. They have a deaf or hard of hearing child that they don't know how to communicate with. It can be quite an overwhelming, stressful experience for them. They need immediate communication with their deaf child. And they need support and assistance with that. So there's differences between these two groups of adult second language users and the support that they need to learn the language. There's a term that I'd like to explain, you know, put out there to you all. It's called plurilingualism. This is how I sign that concept. Plurilingualism has a different way to view what it means to be bilingual. Typically, we ascribe to the old mentality of what bilingualism means, and that means having equal proficiency in both languages. So native-like proficiency is often what people understand by the term bilingualism. There aren't many individuals out there that have exact bilingualism in each language, whether they're deaf or hearing, using English or French. There's few individuals out there that are fully bilingual in more than one language. Plurilingualism, on the other hand, looks at bilingualism at the individual level. There are ranges of fluency, ranges of proficiency in a language. Perhaps the parent will max out at a certain level, but their proficiency in that language is still valuable, and it's still enriching and positive. With plurilingualism, the goal is for lifelong learning. From the birth of your child until the end of your life, you're going to have a deaf child forever. So plurilingualism looks at continued learning over one's life. Just like to touch upon my postdoctoral research briefly, which ties into the research that I've been doing lately for the parent sign language curriculum. My PhD research looked at the Mother Goose ASL program, and my postdoctoral research looked at the ASL shared reading program. Both of these programs are fantastic. The Mother Goose program and the Shared ASL Reading program. However, both of them are lacking in some sense, in that they're lacking basic communication skills that parents need for their interacting with their deaf or hard of hearing child. There were a number of deaf instructors that were hired in this study. Some of them worked at the deaf school in Milton. One of them was an ASL instructor as well as a consultant, but they were all extremely skilled instructors. There were five families that were involved within this study, but two families in particular that came to all of the sessions. So I'll be focusing on these two families in particular. The first family had a son by the name of Robert, and these are pseudonyms, they aren't their real names. So Robert is hard of hearing. His audiological assessment actually said that he was deaf, but he was able to develop spoken language skills on par with a hearing three-year-old. Regardless, his parents still wanted to learn ASL, because they recognized that their son was deaf and he still had that deaf identity piece that needed to be supported. The second family I'd like to focus on had a daughter by the name of Margaret. And again, this is another pseudonym, it's not her real name. Margaret did receive a cochlear implant, however, she was not successful in developing spoken language skills. At that point, her parents decided to start learning ASL. So these two families are coming from very different places. Again, this shows some of the diversity that's represented within these parent groups. I know that there's an awful lot of text here, my apologies. So this program looked at how to teach parents how they could read stories with their children using ASL. However, parents were still very frustrated that they were lacking the basic communication competencies to interact with their child. So that foundation, those basic communication skills, were still lacking. In the province of Ontario, the Infant Hearing Screening Program, if you choose to receive ASL services, There should be LSQ services available as well. Just to put it out there, it is your right if you'd like to receive LSQ services. You can fight and advocate for that. Anyhow, if parents opt to receive ASL or LSQ services, the services that are provided to them are quite minimal. So within a one-year period, parents are allowed to receive 48 hours of ASL services. And this is if they choose the full ASL route. So this equals up to about 1 hour per week with a total of 48 hours per year. And this is throughout their child's span from these ages of 0 to 6. For learning a second language, this is quite a minimal amount of hours. 1 hour per week in ASL services, would you be able to become proficient in that language? Of course it would be quite difficult. So we have to look at why the system is designed that way. There's insufficient language services for parents. If parents choose the dual language approach under the IHP, which means that they will receive both sign language and spoken language services, and that's absolutely all right, their hours of service are cut in half. So the ASL service hours will be halved from 48 hours per year to 24 hours per year. So within a one-month span, the parents are receiving maybe 1 to 2 hours of sign language instruction per month. So of course it's going to be difficult. It would be near impossible for the parents to develop some sense of proficiency in sign language with those minimal amount of hours. So this is what's in place in the IHP program currently. This is the reality of what I found through my studies and my investigation of the IHP. The little girl, Margaret, that was involved in the study, who had received a cochlear implant and was not able to develop spoken language skills, her mother signed this particular excerpt to me. and I felt it was quite profound. Her mother said, "My concern is that I don't know ASL myself. She, my daughter, sees broken ASL and she can't hear enough English, so I feel like she gets both broken English and broken ASL, you know?" Now this statement for me, I will never forget. It was quite profound and impacted me in a deep way. I recognize that we need to support these parents in their acquisition of sign language. And also it spoke to me in that parents are taking on the negative implicatures that experts are telling them when it comes to their ability to learn a sign language. So this says to me that the system has already primed these parents and their children to fail at learning sign language. It's deemed impossible for them to learn the language well enough to be able to support their child. This is a quote from another mother. She's the mom of Robert. She did not sign this quote, but she spoke it for herself, and I was fortunate to have an interpreter with me who could interpret her comment. These particular parents deemed ASL as a backup language. So they preferred to use spoken English with their son, but if his hearing aids were off, or if he had an ear infection, or if there was some kind of issue where they couldn't use spoken English, they would revert to ASL as a backup. Regardless of this, this mother was still frustrated and felt that she did not have enough support to interact with her child in sign language. She wasn't able to understand him and communicate efficiently. So she recognized the need for support as well. So really the point is, if the child can develop spoken language skills, or if they are unable to do so, the parents still want to be able to communicate with them in a sign language. So this ties back into the concept of plurilingualism. Once my study was done of the ASL Shared Reading Program, I had identified some of the issues that were out there, and I recognized that we needed to make a change. We needed to change the approach of how we were supporting these parents and adopting a plurilingualism approach. But I didn't have any sense of how to proceed with this, what to do from this point forward. I felt stuck. I had the evidence in place, I had written the papers that there were issues within the system, but I didn't know how to go about addressing these issues. At this point, I received a new position in Alberta, so my family and I moved out west to Edmonton. During my work there, in the summer of 2013, there was quite a large conference that was hosted in London, England. This conference is called TISLR. It's Theoretical Issues in Sign Language Research. This is quite an elite conference for linguists around the world. If you'd like to be, it's quite difficult to be accepted to present at that conference, or even for a poster session. I wasn't able to attend, unfortunately, but I was curious to see who was presenting at this particular conference. Two names immediately caught my eye. They were two individuals from the Netherlands that were doing a poster presentation at this particular conference. These two individuals are deaf themselves, and they had developed a parent sign language curriculum in the Netherlands using the CEFR. The CEFR is the Common European Framework of Reference for Languages. And this is how we sign that. So the CEFR is used around Europe largely. So in international sign language, we refer to the CEFR like this. So that's where this sign came from. The CEFR looks at teaching second language users a second language specifically.
So the CEFR does implement plurilingualism,
It has creative approaches and ideas to how to support individuals in their second language learning. When I saw that these two women from the Netherlands were presenting on this and their parents' sign language curriculum, I was quite interested in getting in touch with them. I did try to reach out to them via email, but I unfortunately didn't get a response. I have a deaf friend who works in Winnipeg, Manitoba, who is a linguist herself. She's quite well-known. She knows a number of people on a global scale. So I asked if she could get in touch with these two presenters on my behalf. She was able to reach out with them through Facebook, and I was able to connect with them over a Skype meeting. At this time, I was fortunate enough to receive a grant, which I used to fly to the Netherlands to observe their parents' sign language curriculum. After observing their sign language curriculum, I applied for another grant by the name of SHRC. It's quite a large governmental grant, which I was fortunate enough to win. So this is how I've come to focus my attention now for the next 2 years on developing a parent ASL curriculum. These are the two ladies from the Netherlands that I was collaborating with. The woman in the back, her name is Mathilde Digges. She is a teacher, a licensed teacher for kindergarten to grade 12. And the woman in the front here with the glasses is Joni Oyserman. Joni is a sign language instructor and she is a linguist as well. So these two women bring their linguistic knowledge and their knowledge of working with deaf children together to develop this parent ASL curriculum with me. They came to Canada for the first time last August. We worked together for 1 week in Toronto to develop our first parent ASL curriculum course. We had 1 week together to train the instructors for this course. And this was not an easy undertaking by any means. Mathilde and Joni bring a number of skills to the table. Not to mention that the two of them had months upon months to develop their parents' sign language curriculum, whereas we only had 1 week to develop ours within Canada. So we worked in collaboration with each other and with the ASL instructors. We all did not possess the skills necessary to take on this undertaking on our own. We needed to collaborate and pool our skills and resources together. The first parent ASL course was taught this past fall and winter in Toronto. The course is 14 weeks in total, and every week has about 2.5 to 3 hours of instruction per class. So we were trying to build upon those minimal services that the IHP offers to offer something more comprehensive for parents in their acquisition of sign language. We needed the time to come together in the same space. This is the advertisement for the course that we offered, and there were 17 families and parents that came to participate in this course. Half of the class were fathers. And half of the class were mothers. So some of the dads would come if the moms needed to stay home with their kids. But all 17 of these parents attended each and every one of the 14 sessions, which was just fantastic for me to see. Once the course had wrapped up, the parents were eager to have a second course offered. There were two instructors for this particular course. I wasn't instructing myself. I had two deaf instructors come in, one of whom is named Mario Pizzicala. He is a quite experienced sign language ASL instructor. He is just outstanding in working with parents and how to support their needs. The other instructor is named Joanne Cripps. Again, she is extremely skilled in working with deaf children and advocating for their rights. These are my two favorite people, However, they're both in their 60s currently, so I know that they're going to be looking at retirement in the near future. We do need to train more instructors, more young instructors, in the years to come. And it's difficult to find those individuals out there. We need to have that commitment from the deaf instructors that we work with to work through this program and support these parents. The CEFR, when it comes to learning a second language, requires a specific amount of hours that the individual put in. The first course that I offered in the fall and winter was at the A1, the basic introductory level. So the A1 level is a beginner level. It's the breakthrough level. It's developing those basic communication skills. The CEFR has a number of different levels, A1 and A2 at the beginner level, B1 and B2, which is the intermediate level or independent level, which means that the individual can communicate independently, and the C1 and C2 are the more academic advanced levels. Many individuals who reach the C2 level are native language users. CODAs, so children of deaf adults, will typically fall within the C1 level. If we support hearing parents in their learning of a sign language, they will often fall within the B1 to B2 level, so the independent intermediate language level. However, the course that we offered in the fall and winter was at the A1 beginner level. Once the first course was finished, we had an assessment that followed the A1 descriptors, which I will touch upon further in my presentation. So we assessed the parents' language skills at the A1 level. 3 hours per week at 14 hours, plus homework. We did fall short of the 100 hours slightly, but it was still quite a valuable experience. I'll try to wrap up quickly so I don't put everyone to sleep here. Now, I just want to touch upon why the parent curriculum is different from the Signing Naturally curriculum. The CEFR is quite flexible. It's quite dynamic. It looks at where the language is being used and different domains of where the language can be used. Depending on where the language is used, there will be different needs in terms of communication. Signing Naturally is more of a fixed curriculum, whereas the parent CEFR curriculum is more dynamic. It was challenging for the instructors to adapt and adjust their lessons to accommodate what the parents needed to learn. There are four particular domains that we focused on, the personal domain being one of them. So for family life, this is critical. There's also the public domain, which is when you're out in public, going to a doctor's appointment, a bank visit, for example. The third domain is educational, so school life and so forth. And the last domain is occupational. Interpreter training seems to focus most on the public and occupational domains, but again, parents have different needs. The first course focused on the personal and public domains, so the language that's used within the home and within the public. For the A2, the second course that we're offering, we're going to be including the educational domain as well, so that parents can communicate with their child about their school life. So the vocabulary and the activities that we did within this course ascribe to both the personal and the public domain specifically. The CEFR was developed by the Council of Europe, and it can be used for any language. It initially started with spoken language, but it can be adapted to any language in any context in any country. There are a number of skill areas for the spoken language CEFR use. Spoken expression, comprehension as well as reading and writing, so literacy skills. These skill domains were adapted to align with sign language. So we focus on developing comprehension, so live production comprehension, as well as interaction capabilities. So these comprehension and production skills involve both live interaction and video interaction. So again, the course that we worked on focused on developing interactive comprehension and production skills, and the homework looked at production and comprehension skills from a video format. I mentioned the descriptors just a few moments ago. Now, CEFR has descriptors for each of the levels, the A1, the A2, B1, B2 levels, and these descriptors state what the language learner can do. So at the A1 level, I can do XYZ. So this is an example. At the A1 level, I can understand familiar names, signs, and very simple sentences. For example, in recorded videos or DVDs. And this is at the beginner A1 level. So I can do the following. At the A2 level, an example of the descriptor at what one can do at that level is I can understand very short, simple recordings. I can find specific, predictable information in recordings and so forth, such as advertisements and whatnot. So these skills are increased, they're built upon. And we follow these descriptors of what the individual can do in terms of the lesson development and assessing the language learner's skills. Parents like these type of descriptors because they can see what they're able to do, and it gives one a positive sense about their language learning. It also helps them see that they're able to build upon their current skills and develop those further. It provides a sense of motivation to the parents. They can track their progress and feel empowered about what they're able to do with their language skills. This picture is not from too long ago. Joni and Mathilde came to Ottawa about 2 weeks ago for a short period of time, and then we went to Toronto again to work on developing our second course. And again, it's quite a difficult undertaking. This workshop that we did 2 weeks ago was a lot of work developing the second course that we want to offer to parents. We have our first course in place. Again, it's not perfect. There's still some revisions that need to be done, some fine-tuning. However, we've since shifted our focus to developing the second parent ASL course, which we're hoping to offer in the fall of 2015 for another 14 weeks. So this is just to wrap up. This has been a brief overview of my research to date. I would really love to expand the training of instructors some more. I'd like to offer some more classes as well. And I'd really love to offer some support for the LSQ community as well. I know that there's interest for doing this, so if we could work collaboratively in some sense, that would be wonderful. And I just want to put it out there that parents of deaf children, you can learn a sign language, whether it be ASL or LSQ, and it is beneficial. If you're interested, if you have the motivation, you can be successful. So thank you very much for your time this morning. Thank you, everyone. Thank you. That is a beautiful question. Thank you for that. I'm very happy that you asked me that, actually. I didn't really touch upon that as much as I would like to. For parents, the goal, the priority should be communication with their child. you know, whether or not the child can speak with the use of hearing aids or cochlear implants, there needs to be in-depth communication that occurs. And if you learn a sign language, it'll assist with that communication with your child at more of a deeper level. So for example, let's say your grandfather passed away and you have a deaf child and you need to explain to them what's happening. If they're unable to access the spoken language around them, it's the parent's responsibility to explain that. If you have a hearing child, the parent can explain, you know, grandpa passed away, this is what happened, and give a full in-depth explanation. But will your deaf child be able to receive the same information as your hearing children? And hopefully they should be able to receive the same information. They should be able to understand exactly the same things that their hearing siblings can. So for that type of situation, you need to have thorough, clear communication skills with your child to be able to communicate that. Or if your family is getting together for Christmas or Easter and there are a number of hearing family members around, does your deaf child know the name of all of their aunts and uncles and cousins? Perhaps they don't know. And again, it comes back to communication. So yes, it is quite a large responsibility, and parents do need support in that sense. But really, the priority is communication with your deaf child. So the point of this particular course and this curriculum is not for parents to take on all of the responsibility in teaching their child their first language, but so that the parents can communicate with their child in a visual language.